kind of coming up on you, just a little bit more and more. You're healed of that tonight. You're not. Hallelujah. Somebody said, well, you healed me tonight. No, you received it tonight. Come on, we're not worshiping to get him to do something. We worship him because he has done something. All right, now I'm going to read this out of the Amplified in Matthew 15. And Brother Heath, don't go to sleep. In verse 6, so for the sake of your tradition, the rules, this is who's speaking now. This is Jesus, right? How many Bibles have they got red letters?
Yes.
I always say this, if it's in red, it must be red. Says this in verse 6, so for the sake of your tradition, the rules handed down by your forefathers, you have set aside the word of God, depriving it of force and authority, and making it of no effect. You pretenders, hypocrites, admirably and truly did Isaiah prophesy of you when he said, these people draw near me with their mouths, honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far away from me. Uselessly do they worship me, for they teach as the doctrines and commandments of men. Now, I'm not going to leave you on a negative note here. We're just looking at these folk. These are ignorant folk that don't know how to worship, right? So we know this. It says, uselessly do they worship me. Is there such a thing as useless worship? See, some of them have been here too long. They're like, we ain't answering you. Because every time we answer, it's always the opposite. The truth is, yes, you can worship God and it be absolutely useless. Come on, has anybody ever been in prayer meetings and you're just like, why are we praying? This is useless. Not praying being useless, how we're doing it is useless. Come on, you know, begging God, reporting to Him like, you know, Lord, I don't know if you saw this today on CNN or not, but Lord God, help us. We're just begging you, Lord, to help us. Did you see what's going on overseas, Lord? No, He's been busy. He's getting old. He doesn't get to catch everything, you know. If he doesn't have an app for it, he does, you know, come on, Google's competing with God. You know what I'm saying? Hello, stop it. He knows everything. He's omnipotent. He's omniscient. He's all powerful. He's all knowing. He knew all of this stuff. Come on now. So we don't have to report to God junk. Lord, you know how I'm feeling. Of course, he's touched with the feeling of your infirmity. So how do I pray? Praying in faith sometimes almost seems like it's uncompassionate. Because you deal right with the situation as if you've got it now instead of the stuff you're dealing with right now. That doesn't mean God doesn't love us, He doesn't care for us, He doesn't have compassion. Of course He does. I love that poem, Footprints in the Sand. You know, it said, I looked down, I looked like I was the only one walking, and He said, no, son, that was the time I was carrying you. Come on. I thank God for that. But the truth of the matter is this, He's not just carrying us anymore. He's given us authority to stand, therefore stand. He's given us authority to walk, so therefore walk. He's given us authority to run our race, so therefore run. Glory to God. He's given us authority to win every single battle because He already won it for us. So again, am I worshiping to get Him to do something, or am I worshiping because He's just that good? And I'm telling you, you can't know the God I know and not worship this God. You cannot know this God that I'm talking about and not worship Him.
Yes.
Go on, shepherds should never have to take their Bible and use it as a sheep prod to get you to do what sheep do. Oh, I get to worship Him. I don't have to.
Yes.
I get to.
Yes.
It takes me to another level.
Yes.
When you worship God, you go to another level. You have a whole other bird's eye view of the situation.
Yes.
And why do you think God thinks everything's so small? Because He's so big. I like this revelation the Lord gave me one time, and you don't have to write it down. I see a lot of you are taking notes, but you know, at least get this in the tablet of your heart. Whenever a giant rises up against you, just know that my Lord said this to me one time when a giant rose up against me. He goes, son, that's just a giant.
Yes.
Yes. We're sitting there going, God, look at the giant. He goes, it's just a giant. Come on, greater is He that is in me than he that's in the world. You, on your weakest day, is stronger than any giant on his best day. It's just a giant. Woo!
Come on now.
You're getting weak in night preaching now. You're getting Friday night preaching. I'm not gonna, all right, I won't give this out on Sundays that often, but I'll give it to you on Friday night. It's tonight, you're in the club. Boom, the club of the Lord. I'm just kidding. Come on.
That's all right.
Club and baby sheep tonight. Boom. What, somebody finally gonna get on the organ? All right, good. No, I'm teasing. Now listen here. He said, uselessly, Jesus said this in verse 9, uselessly do they worship me. Was their worship going up to him? Yes. Were they worshiping him? Yes. But what did Jesus call it? Useless. Oh my goodness. So we got to make sure that we don't have signs on our worship life that say to the unknown God, I'm worshiping him, but I don't know if he'll do it. He may do it, he may not. That's not who we're worshiping. We're worshiping the one we know, as the word says, and you know him. If I know him, in the Bible, a lot of times when you hear that phrase, know, that meant to be intimate with. Know, worship actually, when you break down the Hebrew, means to kiss the face of God. You are literally being intimate with God, not goofy, not crazy, not weird. You are literally showing affection to the one who gave you breath to breathe. You are giving affection to the one that gives you. Look, if the devil could have killed you by now, you'd be dead. But the fact that you're not dead is you still got something to do.
Yeah.
And if you're still here and you're still breathing, what does the word say in Psalm 150? Everything that has breath. Oh, no, you didn't. You just quoted the scripture. But do you hear what? Everything that's breathing is praising.
Yes.
And I'm going to say it like this. It's like an oxygen tank. When I exhale worship, he inhales my praise. And when he inhales my praise, he exhales his life.
Yes.
So when I inhale his life, I'm breathing.
Yes.
And when you have breath, it's cyclical. It's a pattern. Yes. I get to keep life in me just through my worship life. You have to get a new bus driver after tonight. He may get laid out on the floor worshiping God. Hallelujah. Is there anything stronger than the Word of God?
No.
This is her first night. A lot of y'all don't know this, but this is my dear sister. We're related. We go to the same hairdresser. She's got beautiful hair. A lot of y'all, you can probably see the resemblance now. They call us the Skunks of Funk, man. I tell you. We got the funk. Come on. Yeah. All right, now. You see how I just went down to a whole nother level? Because people are like, because they know that song. I don't know it. I was just testing you. That was word of knowledge. All right. Thank you. But is anything stronger than the Word of God? We've heard no. Somebody said no. And I will say, you are right to a point. In raw power, what's stronger than the Word of God? Because God is His Word. In raw power, there is nothing stronger than the Word of God. In raw power. But in a person's life, there is many things that can be stronger than the Word of God. And according to what Jesus said here, He said this, for the sake of your tradition, the rules handed down by your forefathers, you have set aside the Word of God, depriving it of force, power, and authority. So it sounds to me like there is something that can be a lot stronger than the Word of God in our life, and that's tradition. Did you know tradition will keep people worshiping an unknown God? You can't know Him without me. That's Old Testament. The Word says you do know Him. Now how about this? Traditions will keep you uselessly worshiping Him. This is how I do it. This is the way I do it. I don't have to lift my hands. Here we go. I don't got to lift my hands. He knows me. He knows my heart. He knows me. He knows my heart. That's just the way I am. I'm just being real. Yeah, real carnal. Oh, this is good. Maybe I should have taken up the offering first. But anyway, here we go. Listen now. Follow me. I'm here to help you. I'm not bashing. bashing you. I'm bashing that traditional evil spirit that has kept God's children so bound that they can't worship God because they're in a spiritual straitjacket. And when they're sitting there and the pastor's talking, you can tell who's bound up. They physically wear it, and they ain't rapping. Say, don't run DMC in here. But what's happening is, when you stand up and you see somebody like this, they think they're honoring God. But if they're doing more than that at a ball game, they're traditionally, religiously, uselessly worshiping God. Getting out of your landmines. That was close. Listen. If somebody's worshiping God just by being in the house and thinking everybody else worshiping around them is good enough, they're not worshiping. They're in a worship service where others are worshiping God.
All right.
I've been there. I know what it's like. When I first started getting into this, I knew it was okay to lift your hands. But cool guys don't lift hands. They'll fold hands. They'll stand with a swagger. They don't know what I'm talking about, do they? They don't know how to drive no bus. And I said, you know, and you know, you might even do one of these. Get that head bobbing. But I ain't going to shut my eyes long because I don't want somebody coming up on me. When's the last time you got jacked in church? Don't say me, because I'll come down, I'll hit you. I remember when I was looking up at heaven, and I was thinking, God, I know you're real. I want to lift my hands, but I feel so uncomfortable. That's when I got the revelation. He said, it's uncomfortable because you never do it. He said, it's uncomfortable because you're too concerned. What are people going to think about? Oh, I know I'm in the wrong house again tonight, but let me work it out. I'm telling you, I know what it's like. And when I put that hand up, the devil was on the other side. I go, what are you doing, fool? And you just go right back down. Now, I know I'm talking to professional praisers in here. But I'm going to say this. If your heart's not in it, the opposite is also true with those that are doing all the outward, whoa, Jesus, thank you! You know, and they're all out there being loud and obnoxious and annoying and, you know, praising and whack, hey, glory, whack, smacking and hitting people's knees out of place. And their heart's not in it, but their performance is. But tonight, dare I say, everybody was worshiping God from their heart. Everybody. How many of you felt something change in your body? Just focusing on the Lord, having that junk in Him. We didn't leave it in Him. He took it into Him. But that was our point of contact. Man, when we were doing healing school, we saw some of the most amazing miracles. Crowds were starting to come out in record. People, they could not keep up with all the testimonies. People were getting healed so much. People would leave and didn't report their healing. They would just leave just in awe. Wow. That's how many were happening. Hundreds were coming, getting healed because of that revelation right there. They saw their pain in His body, not theirs. So is anything stronger than the Word of God? Well, the answer is in a person's life. Yes, it's the traditions, it's the doctrines, the commandments of men. It's what men have made the Word to say instead of allowing it to speak what it says. Turn with me over to Matthew. I know we're right there, but let's go over here to Matthew chapter... Yeah, we could go there. Let's go to John. We'll come back to Matthew. Is that okay? Good. John. Thank you, Lord. Anybody getting anything out of this?
Yeah.
Glory to God. I'm telling you, if you sit on the third row, people get healed. G-
People that sit on the fifth row, they get healed.
Yeah.
People that get on the sixth row, they get healed.
Yeah, thank you, Lord.
But people on the fourth row, never is there anything that ever goes on here. Very rarely. There's nothing happening there. It truly is a pew. John chapter 4. The joy of the Lord is our... Laughter does good like a bitter poison. Like a medicine. Some of y'all need to overdose. You have permission tonight. It's Friday. It's time to get your party on. I was a good alcoholic in the day. And I'll tell you right now, I knew I'd have a good time in the day. But if I can't have a better time in church, then somebody's not preaching it right. Somebody's not teaching it right, or somebody's not letting it happen right. Come on. So you got permission in here tonight to leave as full of joy as you would like. If you want to stay dignified, I pray you get hit twice as hard. Because the dignified drunk is the one that thinks they got it together, and when they stand up, they go, "Whoa, who moved the earth?" We got a wheelbarrow just for you. John chapter 4 and verse 6. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being weary with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the sixth hour. Now the sixth hour is about 12. There came a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus said unto her, "Give me to drink." Now most of us know this portion of Scripture, but I want you to hear something at least fresh tonight. If you've heard something already before, that's fine, but I want you to hear it fresh. Too many times we take the minister down the road we always go down, and therefore we bypass any revelation that's flowing. I already heard that. I know where we're going. Well, hold on. The woman of Samaria. Why would they say Samaria? So that we can know where he's at on the map? Well, it's more than that. She's from Samaria and he's Jewish. So whether you know it or not, I'm going to be the first one, maybe the third one, maybe the 15th one that you've heard this from. But right away, there is a racial issue at hand. And what's even worse is not only is there a racial issue, there's a gender issue. Men talking to women. Not only is there a racial and a gender issue, we see another issue that's at hand. But we'll get into that in just a moment. But it's a spiritual issue. And he said in verse 7, there came a woman of Samaria to draw. Jesus said unto her, "Give me to drink, for his disciples were gone away into the city to buy some meat." Then said the woman of Samaria back unto him, "How is it that you, being a Jew, ask drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans." Racial issues. Racism. The ugliest demonic spirit that I think I know of. At least one of the top three. You know what I mean? Racism is the person that does not understand who they are in Christ. What's really sad is Creflo Dollar. How many of y'all know him? How many of y'all know his half brother, 50 Cent? But anyway, Creflo Dollar. I'll let them get that in a minute. Somebody's writing it down. Ooh, this is good. Half dollar. Half dollar. Half brother. 50 Cent. What? Oh, that's a joke. Anyway. Creflo, I saw at a meeting here in Tulsa, the first man to address racism in a body of believers, where there was whites, Hispanics, Asians. I mean, it was all over the place. I mean, people. He said, "I want you, if you've had racial issues with any other brother of any other color and any other mother, to go and I want you to hug them and get it right." How about that? I didn't have any issues, but I'm just standing there weeping. I want to hug somebody. Nobody came to me. And then the Lord said to me these words. He says, "I want you to do what he does with the white people." Interesting, huh? Where he's a voice to help in that situation. Because he's bold. I am too. I'm anointed just like he is. And we have been seeing that barrier destroyed Because racism in the church was never a vision God ever had. Racism in America was never a vision that God has ever had. And I'm going to tell you right now, the more we keep focusing on it, the more we keep feeding it. I know there may be some dumb rednecks out there that don't understand and they are ignorant. That doesn't mean that we need to be dumb rednecks on this side and keep feeding into that. Because thank God Michael Jordan didn't see himself as a dumb redneck. Thank God Tiger Woods, well, at one point he's working things out. All right, but anyway, what I'm saying is, thank God Martin Luther King did not look at himself as a dumb redneck. Thank God he wasn't bound by barriers that aren't even existing except for somebody trying to feed him. Thank God he had a dream. Now most of us in here need to wake up too. Alright, I'll get off of that. Because I see already, you know, there's one exit and I'm not real close to it. Alright, here we go. I'd send Tammy out to warm the car up, but I think she'd just leave me here and just say, Lord, bless him, save him, help him. He was a good man. Nothing like having angry black women up on you, you know? I mean, you are not going to win that one. Have you ever noticed that? Is he there? Is he there? Yeah, you know what I'm talking about. That's why you're hiding. You're just being, I call it hiding. You're saying you're submitting. But anyway. So there's an issue, it's a spirit. Racism has been around ever since here, John 4. Wow, it's a spirit. Guess what, you do not have to yield to it. Remember what I said earlier in some of these services? What other people say about you ain't none of your business. What other people think about you ain't none of your business. What you think and say about you is. If you keep ascribing and keep agreeing with everybody, you'll never make it. You'll never amount to anything. You'll never do anything. You know what? Hello? I wouldn't even be where I'm at if I only lived on what other people said. Because there's people that can see you're going somewhere that will say you're not to keep you where they're at. But if you don't listen to that, then you'll keep going where you're supposed to go. Look at your neighbor and say, I'll see you later. All right, now. You know it's getting good when somebody goes, hey. In verse 10, Jesus answered and said unto her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that said to you, give me to drink, you would have asked of him and he would have given you living water. The woman said unto him, sir. Now notice, she went to, who do you think you are as a Jew talking to me, a Samaritan? To seeing a little bit more respect, knowing that a man and a woman shouldn't be talking out in public like this. But she starts to respect him and then says, sir. All right, now hold on. Sir, I perceive you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. So where are you going to get this living water? Now see, when you think it only comes from a certain place, when you think it's only coming a certain way, you'll always only have your eyes and your gaze on a certain thing. For God to use a certain thing to get you what you are believing for. Oh, but when you trust Him wholeheartedly and full, it doesn't matter at all. If He doesn't have a bucket, He can give you living water. He may not even use the well that you're coming to always get your drink. Because this is what I always do. This is the pew I always sit in. This is when I always go to church. This is how I always worship. I'm telling you, He can go all the way around that and cause you, like Peter, like we saw the other night, to be needing a paycheck one minute and retiring the next. So here now, he goes on and says, she says, are you greater than our father Jacob? Which gave us the well and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle. Number one, I don't want to be drinking out of no well some cow's been slopping in. But all right, nonetheless. She is not just dealing with a racial issue. She's not just dealing with a gender issue. She's now dealing with a spiritual issue in the fact that are you thinking that you're greater than our father Jacob? What did we just see in Matthew 15? The Word of God deprived of its power, its effects, and its authority because of traditions of men. Here she is being traditional and doesn't even realize that the one that could break her free of all traditions is right in front of her. How do you know that he's going to break all traditions? Because he just broke the one with racism. Come on, somebody follow me. He just broke the one with racism by being a Jew talking to a Samaritan woman. He also broke the gender issue because he's a man. Now he's talking to a woman in public. And now he's getting ready to break all spiritual issues with her. He just is a law breaker and a law fulfiller so that we could have our breakthrough. Come on, somebody. And so here now, it says in verse 13, Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinks of this water shall thirst again. Isn't that funny? We always want God to bless us in the place we want Him to bless us in, and we don't realize that we're going to be thirsty and hungry again even after He blesses us in that place. But here we go now. But whosoever drinks of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up unto everlasting life. That's why Jesus said over in John 7, he says on that last great day of the feast, he stood and cried and said, if any man thirst, let him come unto me, for out of my belly shall flow rivers of living water. How many of us are walking around, and honestly, let's just take inventory. I don't want to see a sign of hands, but let's just take inventory right now. Do we have living water pouring out of us, or are we just spitting some old traditional dust? People come to those who have something to give, and they won't even know you've got it. They'll just be drawn to it. Same is true when people know you ain't got nothing. They don't ask for nothing. And you're sitting around traditionally, I got something. Come on, come and get you some of this. What is that, angel dust? Oh, you get that. Oh, I knew the bus driver had my back. The bus. All right, now here we go. I like this. Instead of getting into this deep, drawn-out Jerry Springer episode with her, he messes her up and just shuts it down. The woman said unto him, sir, give me this water that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. All of a sudden, she went from being needy to greedy. And here's what Jesus said. Go call your husband. What does that have to do with anything? Just give me some water. Show me how to get this living water. Don't be talking about no husband. As a matter of fact, I don't have a husband. Come on. Starts trying to lie to him. And then he goes on and says, yeah, you spoke in the right things that you had no husband. As a matter of fact, you've had five. How many of y'all think that this reminds you of a relative? All right, anyway, so go on. You have had five husbands, and he whom thou now hast is not your husband. Am I talking the truth? What does this have to do with getting a drink of water? You ain't even supposed to be talking to me. You're Jewish. You ain't supposed to be talking to me. You're a man. We're in public. You ain't supposed to be talking to me about any of this. You're messing up my whole life. When you start realizing there's a well in front of you everywhere you go, people will meet you at that well that they didn't even expect to encounter God's greatness in you. Say, oh well. Now listen here. The woman said unto him, sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. You think? Our fathers worshipped in this mountain. Isn't it funny what she keeps really going back to? The spiritual issue. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain. And you say that in Jerusalem, that's the place where men ought to worship. Jesus said unto her, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when you shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. You worship, you know not what. Which means what? Ignorant, useless worship. It must have been an epidemic back then too. Useless, ignorant worship. But what does he go on to say? But he that worships me must worship me in spirit and in truth. How deep can I go with this, Pastor? Now, I know for the most part, just in my spirit, what I'm getting ready to say isn't applicable to your worship leader, okay? But I am going to go and let you know that most strife in churches are in the worship team. Why? Because of pride. Pride? Why? That's what God blessed them with, that talent. God blessed them with that ear. God blessed them with that voice. And some of them, we know God didn't bless them with anything, but they signed up anyway. But God blessed them with the ability. Then why would it be pride if they're just being confident? Because of the heart. Ezekiel 28 talks about how the most beautiful, perfect angel that was created, Lucifer. Anybody else know another name for him? The devil. Before he became Satan, he was the beautiful worship leader, chief musician, Lucifer. Says he was created perfect. There was no guile found in him, and he was just perfect. He had pipes built into him. Do you understand? Not only was he beautiful, he sang perfectly, he worshiped perfectly, he was perfect. Now we see why he fell. Because of the way he started to get into himself, being perfect, looking good, singing good, playing good, worshiping good, started getting followers. Come on, are you hearing me? We know he had followers. At least a third of the angels fell with him. So if he is so beautiful and so perfect, why would God create something like this? Because he creates them with a will so that he will see if they will serve him and him alone. Nothing's different now except we're redeemed. Thank God for his redemption. Now check this out. Most strife in the worship team is a spirit, the satanic spirit. All strife is, really. But why does it seem to attack in the worship? Because if I can get the worship team out of sync, then when they're worshiping, they may sound good on the outside, but nothing's happening, and I'm okay with ignorant, useless, traditional worship. Because he knows if he can get you with your non-singing ability to offer up a joyful noise of praise, come on, and it's not sounding good to nobody, dogs are howling in the street, but God is not. He's accepting it. And by the time he receives your true heart of worship with your non-sounding good self, look at your neighbor and say, that's you with me, Houston. I didn't say with me. I said with me. Because every time you sing, it's like I'm getting beaten in the head. No, I'm teasing. And so you're going to worship. God perfects your praise. And by the time it gets to him, it can't get no better. So what others may be judging down here and making it, oh, what are they doing? Oh, they're killing people with their, you know. Come on. You are doing it from your heart. And God is receiving it with his heart and his perfected praise. Yes. But guess who's down here hearing that note wasn't perfect? You went flat when you should have gone sharp. Come on. Who's down here doing that? Who's judging all that, nitpicking that? Making you self-conscious instead of God-conscious. The enemy. The one who fell from heaven as fast as lightning. The one who used to be the chief musician. The one who was the ultimate worship leader with pipes built into him. Beautiful worship came out of him. Do you understand? And so he's thinking, that doesn't sound anything like what I can do. Oh, come on now. Hear this. That doesn't sound like anything that I was able to do in heaven. Now, that's his opinion. Because he's full of pride and deceit. So he wants you, who's been given his job. I'm letting that sink in. The enemy wants you, who's been given his job, to stop doing what he doesn't think you can do as good as him. So he causes strife. He starts causing division. How did he fall from heaven? Strife and division. Pride. So hear me now. Pride comes before us. So hear this. If he can get you to stop worshiping God, you no longer have his job. He'll never have. I have to hit something. Come on, high five me. I mean, I got to smack something. Do you understand how important that is? You, through the blood of Jesus, have been given the ultimate position he always esteemed as having that made him even feel like one day he would trump God. Worship no longer was to God. Worship was about him. generation. I know you know it. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing that I've made it. Because it's all about you. Come on. Come on, 2 Samuel. Are you getting anything tonight besides excited to worship God? Come on, 2 Samuel. Let's go to the 6th chapter. I don't know about you, but a lot of food's gone out this week. And I hope you're digesting it. I hope you're not treating it like a fast food joint, trying to have it your way. But in 2 Samuel chapter 6, we see something here interesting about King David. Of course, he's married. I don't care if you call her name Michael. I don't care if you call her name Michal. I don't care if you say it's Mitchell. The bottom line is, this is his wife, and I'm going to pronounce it Michael. Look at your neighbor and say, don't mess with him. He obviously is angry. All right, now, I ain't angry. Come on. Oh, did you feel that?
Yes, I did.
Oh. I heard that. You're still healed, right? I saw your sister picking up her club right there in the form of a cane. I thought, oh no, she's getting ready to take care of me. You should have seen her face, man. That's scary. She smiled but looked at me like, I could kill you. 2 Samuel chapter 6. In verse 18, and as soon as David had made an end of offering, oh, I'm sorry, I've been trying not to say anything about offering because too many people always think that's the most demonic time of the service. Stop it. It's some of the most worshipful time. And if you start worshiping God with your offering, as a tool of sacrifice, as a tool as offering, you can start going and driving to the hospital and just say, Lord, I thank you for favor. And that's all you have to say, just that smoothly, and then a $5,000 bill is erased. I'm going to tell them one. Before I get going on this, I'm just going to talk to you about this. As soon as David had made an end of offering, burnt offerings, peace offerings, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord of hosts. Now, there was this lady that was in one of our services. This meeting had extended for 5 weeks, believe it or not. Thank God for pastors that are open for extended meetings. Amen. I believe this side is going to get just as filled as this side before it's all said and done. We're just on the beginning of this brink of what God's doing on the north side and in this church and in your heart. Now here's what he said. This lady said, she goes, I want to testify. I said, sure. She took the mic out of my hand. You never let that happen. That's why God allowed men to create these. These are harder to take. And so, like, man, you all been drinking NyQuil before you came here tonight. That's all right. I can see it on you, too. You're all like, amen. Looking like Elvis before he passed out. So anyway, she wants to testify. She took the mic. The first thing she said is, when I first heard you, I didn't like you. That's not a good testimony, in my opinion. That is not starting out good at all. When I first heard you, I didn't like you. I don't need to hear that. What's wrong with you? You got problems? Give me the mic. But I couldn't get it. And so she said, but I want to tell you, I hear you talk about the offering. I get so mad. I'm thinking this is getting worse. She doesn't like me. She's getting mad. She's about to ruin it for all the people, well, the two people that like me. Don't mess with this. And she says, I was listening to you, and on the last night of Friday night, she said, well, you know, this is Monday night, she said, Friday night, I didn't have much in my purse, but what I had, I gave it all in the offering. So now I went from being angry with her to super scared. I'm like, no, that's not what I told you to do. I did not say to do that. You know what I mean? It's like I need an attorney just to preach. You know what I'm saying? So this is what she said. You are teaching us to hear from God, and whatever God says to do, do it. And she said, that's what he told me to do. I'm like, I'm thankful God told you to do that. But see, he won't tell you to empty your purse or your wallet if you just give like you're supposed to. See, that's, you get that. All right, now, She was fighting it. She had been in church. She had all these debts. One that she had was a $100,000 tax bill, IRS. $100,000. Six figures. And she's sitting there going, God told me to sow. You had said if it's not meeting your need, then it's obviously your seed. She goes, so I took you at your word. And I'm sitting there going, dear God, I hope she didn't come here with a gun. You know, wouldn't that be terrible? And so the way the end of this testimony goes, the pastor dies. Boom. You know, I didn't want that. Of course, it wouldn't work. I'd still be alive. You know how that goes. It just makes the devil mad. But here, anybody hear that story about John Hagee when he was ministering and that guy came walking down the aisle popping his gun at him? Did you hear about that? And all the bullets went all the way around him. Have you seen John Hagee? Stevie Wonder could have been a sharpshooter with this man. Okay, that guy takes up some real estate. And he could have been easily popped. You know what I'm saying? But God protected him. God protected him. You're protected. I don't know who that's for, but somebody's been in fear, bad fear recently. You're protected. You're fine. Enemy can't touch you. Come on now, you need to be praising God and saying, you can't touch this. I am so glad my sister came tonight. Only people with cool hair really get what I'm saying. All right, now. Is yours a toupee too? No, I'm teasing. It's real. I know some of you are like, I can't believe that's real. He needs to shoot that thing. But anyway, so here we are, and she's testifying, and the Lord really was moving in that service, and this woman gets up and drops this bomb about a six-figure tax bill, $100,000 tax bill she owes the IRS, and God told her Friday night to sow seed against her debts, and that she said, I did it, and her face was just rock. It didn't change. I didn't like you. God told me to sow everything I had. And I'm like, change your face. I'm trying to read it, you know. Smile, something. And so she said, I got on the phone this morning. God told me to call the IRS to work out some payment arrangement. So she said, I got on the phone. I was on the phone for a long time. I got shifted to this office. And I got shifted to that office. And I want you to get a hold of this, all right? She said that I was about to hang up. And they came back on the other line. Another lady said she was a supervisor and said, ma'am, we don't do this very often. But in your case, we're going to forgive your entire $100,000 debt. You can keep doing your own personal Bible study right now if you want to, but this is good stuff. Sometimes we just want information, but I'm telling you, inspirational information is revelation, and that will change your life. If it'll happen for that staunchy lady, come on, you know you're not that staunchy. If God will do it for her, and he'll do it for me, and he'll do it for Brother Heath, come on, and he'll do it for Pastor, and he'll do it for your neighbor, he'll do it for you. The whole reason I told you about being blessed as much as we have been in the recession is because if I am not seeing this, I can't preach it with passion. I can't help lead you out of something. The recession is a facade of the enemy that people are buying into and making it their reality. So you do not have to make it your reality. If you sow in the time of famine, you'll reap in the time of famine. Yeah. So here now, David gets called out by his wife. Goes on, says in verse 19, and he dealt among all the people, even among the whole multitude of Israel, as well to the women as men, to everyone a cake of bread, a good piece of flesh, and a flagon of wine. So all the people departed, everyone to his house. Then David returned to bless his household. Notice this, true worshipers are always looking to bless somebody. I said true worshipers are always going out of their way looking to bless somebody. And Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet David and said, how glorious was the king of Israel today, who uncovered himself today in the eyes of the handmaids and of his servants, as one of the vain fellows shamelessly uncovers himself. David said unto Michal, it was before the Lord, which chose me before your father, and before all his house, to appoint me ruler over the people of the Lord. And listen to this, he says this, therefore will I play, the Amplified says, make merry and pure enjoyment even more so before the Lord. Come on, you can't keep a good worshiper down. Isn't it funny that there was somebody there to persecute him right after the offering and right after his worship? Isn't it sad when nobody else will persecute you? It seems like your closest person will. Sometimes family members will persecute you and you're like, what is going on? Have you ever been in a good service, a good meeting, and as soon as you get up and walk out of the place, somebody comes up to you that was even in the service and will say something as silly as since we've been on this, will say, what'd you do to your hair? I'm like, Sister Crackhead, weren't you just in the same service I was in? I'm hearing from God, and you're sitting there going to be a puppet for the enemy. And trying to pull you out of that worship. Trying to pull you out of that presence. And persecute you. And the enemy will even come along. But people are people, you know. But the enemy was walking and working and talking through Michael, his wife. And saying, didn't you look great? Just being a mockery. Being sarcastic. Look at you, uncovering yourself. That didn't mean he was running around naked. We're not going to have one of them services, all right? I'm sorry, Brother Heath, we are not. Put your shoes on. But I'm going to tell you right now. If they can't laugh at those little things, how will they laugh at the stuff I bring up about them? All right, good. Now, I see you. Your Bible's upside down. Stop pretending to read it when I walk by. Golly. Trying to tell me that's the Hebrew version. Turn it upside down. Now it's English. All right, now. I know. Somebody's like, why is this happening? This is tomfoolery in church. You know what's tomfoolery in church? Is the rules and traditions that keep people more bound than when they came in. Man, if I can get you to start just laughing a little bit, just being excited. You know, it doesn't even have to be funny. You can laugh, just go ha ha ha. Laughter does good like a medicine. It doesn't have to be funny. You know how I know? Because I haven't been